Welcome, everyone. It's great to have you here with us today. We're going to have a great conversation. I know we're all going to end with some new aha moments. We've been doing these virtual park bench chats for a year since the world turned upside down. And I just wanted to start by saying, first of all, happy almost Earth Day to everybody. You know, one thing I've really loved about these park bench chats is that they've helped us to explore how the important work we do to make sure everyone has access to green space intersects with so many other issues, with the health crisis, with economic recovery, with progress on systemic social change. So I'm just thrilled that you've been able to join us for many of these events, and thank you for continuing to tune in. I know you've brought your questions today for our great speakers. Before I start, I just want to take a couple of minutes to talk about the verdict from the George Floyd murder case and the continued violence that people of color especially are experiencing in their communities. You know, I know all of us watched parts of the trial, all of us watched the verdict, and I will say that accountability is the first step. I was relieved by the result, but I don't think that this is justice. Justice will be when people like George Floyd, Dante Wright, Adam Toledo are still alive and thriving, and our work continues. I want to address, though, where TPL fits in. You know, the society we're building together, the societies we seek together and work with our work with communities is a society where everyone belongs, where the health, climate, equity, and community benefits of public spaces, of parks, of open spaces are available to everyone. And I do think that building that has become even more urgent during the pandemic, even more urgent as we think about the conflicts that were so starkly dramatized by George Floyd's tragic death. And I think the Trust for Public Land can play an important role as we seek to reverse the decades of division and disparity in access to parks. So I just wanna invite you to continue to work with us to that future. I know I feel a sense of urgency, and I know so many of you as volunteers, as supporters do as well. I am really, really excited about today's panel. And we talk in this forum a lot about, as I said, the intersections that people don't always think about. And I think we're gonna have some new ones today. We have two truly global leaders who are part of the movement to really put our cities to work for communities, for the social change that we're looking for justice, for climate and health. The cities cover only a tiny percentage of land on this planet, but most people on the planet now call cities home. And so we're going to be digging specifically into the housing system in cities and how it has become a symptom and a cause of continuing racial disparities in the country and a driver of climate change. And then we're going to talk a little bit about how thoughtful and collaborative design can really lay a foundation for a more just and equitable future. And we're going to talk about a new model for cities that prioritizes climate resilience, prioritizes health, and prioritizes access to quality green space. We'll also be talking about how public spaces can really enable social connections that we need. One of the things that TPL does well is connect people across traditional divides. And I think we feel that even more today than we did, say, a year ago when this pandemic started. So I want to introduce our guests. With me today is Dana Bourland. She is Vice President at the JPB Foundation. She's led the development of the environmental portfolio at the JPB Foundation and direct strategy there, focusing on energy, on environmental health, on green infrastructure, and on field strengthening. Dana is also the author of the recently released, and thank you for writing it, Dana, recently released book called Gray to Green Communities, A Call to Action on the Housing and Climate Crisis. I found this a very inspiring read. And she's gonna talk about how we move away from the gray model of housing to a green model that really takes into account the health and well-being of people, of communities, and of the planet. So Dana has an incredible background. She was a resident at the Rockefeller Foundation's Bellagio Center, and she was named one of Fast Company magazine's most influential women activists in technology, well-deserved. The JPB Foundation and the Trust for Public Land have been working together over the past 5 or 6 years to really increase equitable access to parks and green space. So very, very glad to have Dana joining us. Dana, welcome.
Thank you.
I'd also like to welcome Liz Ogbu. Liz is a designer and urbanist and a spatial justice activist. She's done an incredible variety of work around the world, from designing shelters for immigrant day laborers in the United States to a water and health social enterprise for low-income Kenyans. Liz has an incredibly long history of working with communities in and leveraging the power of design to catalyze sustainable social impact. Currently, she is continuing that work through Studio O, which is a multidisciplinary consulting firm. And we've been very fortunate at TPL to collaborate with Liz on India Basin, which is an impressive project in San Francisco. And we'll be hearing more about that during today's discussion. Her projects have been featured all over in museums. She's an IDEO.org Global Fellow. She's a TED speaker. I highly recommend her TED talk. It's fantastic. She's an Aspen Ideas Scholar, a Senior Fellow of Design Futures Council, and one of Public Interest Design's top 100. So we are really thrilled to welcome Liz. And Liz, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, it's a pleasure.
It's really an honor to have the two of you join us, and I want to get quickly to the conversation. Before we start, I want to talk a little bit about Berkeley, California, which is where I'm sitting. We're talking about cities today and how cities drive a more just and equitable future. And I want to just take a moment to recognize the land where I live in Berkeley, California, which is part of a region of cities that are grappling with systemic inequities, where the Trust for Public Land has done some of our most meaningful work for almost 50 years. Now, for some of you listening today, land acknowledgement might be a new practice. And we recognize the land and the history of land because we want to express gratitude and appreciation to those whose territory and land we reside on. It's a way of honoring the indigenous people who have been living and working in this land for thousands of years. Land acknowledgements are not just about the past. They're not about historical context. They're about what's going on now. And I believe that those of us, especially working in land conservation, have a real duty to understand and think about all of the connections of land and people. And so I want to observe, Berkeley sits on the territory, Hootchin territory, which is the ancestral and unceded land of the Ohlone people. And in pre-colonial times, the Ohlone lived in more than 50 distinct groups. They didn't think of themselves as a single unified group. And the Hootchin territory is composed of what we now think of as Alameda, Berkeley, Emeryville, El Cerrito, and most of Oakland. There's sacred and archaeological sites in Berkeley and Emeryville that show that the Ohlone family of tribes have been living in the Bay Area for 6,000 years. And the territory served as a hub for trade, for intercontinental trade and for coastal trade as well. So as a member of the Berkeley community, I recognize the history of the land that I'm privileged to call home now, and the Muwekma Ohlone people who are alive and flourishing members of our community today. So let's get started. We're gonna have a chat with Liz and Dana for the next about 20 minutes. And then we're gonna turn to questions from the audience. And if you haven't joined us before, as a reminder, you can enter the questions in the Q&A at any time during the conversation, and we'll get to them later on. So today we're gonna lay out a vision for what healthier, more just, and resilient cities look like. But I want to start with looking backward and talk about how we got to where we are. I think that's such an important part of talking about how we get to the future. And Dana, in your book, which I really enjoyed, you talked about the country's reliance on extraction from people and extraction from nature since our origins, and how that laid the groundwork for what you call the twin crises in our housing system. Can you talk just a little bit about how we got here and what the impacts you see are?
Yeah, terrific. Thank you, Diane. And thanks for having me today. This is terrific. And thanks for all of you for joining. And I do also just want to respect those who are joining more audible and not seeing us. So I'm Dana. I'm a white woman. I have brown hair. I'm wearing clear glasses. I have a blue shirt on. I'm sitting in front of a white closet. And to my right, there are a few of my favorite books on housing and also some green sprigs to celebrate spring. So I really, Diane, appreciate you starting us off with the land acknowledgement. You know, I'm zooming in today from occupied Lenape and Wappinger land. And as I start my book off saying, you know, one of the first steps in transitioning from gray to green communities is acknowledging the history of our land and its people, and recognizing land sovereignty and the right of the community to have effective access to, control over, and use of their land. And it's really the best place for me to start, even unpack that humongous question you just put forward about how did we get here? I'm really not equipped to give that full sort of answer, nor do we have the time to give it a complete response. But let me share this quote that I think sums it up in a nutshell by Kianga Yamata Taylor in her book, Race for Profit. There has not been an instance in the last 100 years when the housing market operated fairly without racial discrimination. And so, you know, you go back to the history of our country in 1619, 20 enslaved Africans brought over to the British colonies in Virginia at that time against their will, extracting them from their country to build this country. And that carries forward into the Indian Removal Act, where President Jackson drew up a map and then forced Eastern tribes to move west to the Mississippi, promising, you know, 130 acres of land, 90 acres of which, you know, have been lost over time, if you can imagine that. And the same has happened to Black farmers of who have forested lands and thriving farms. Because we didn't provide access for them to the legal system, they weren't able to take advantage of some of our federal loans to upkeep their land, and over time lost access to these properties. And the USDA has recognized it as the leading cause of Black involuntary land loss. So I sort of give that brief history because that's where we are today with our housing system. We have had this sense that we can take whatever materials we need, take whatever resources we need, and build whatever kind of housing we want, wherever we want it. And quite frankly, we just have to stop that. And we're in this sort of incredibly historic time where the people who are experiencing the housing and climate crises firsthand have had the very least to do with getting us here today. And so, you know, I think that it's this way of thinking that has gotten us where we are today, that we can just build our way out of anything without any consideration for how these systems are connected to one another. And certainly our housing and our climate crisis are connected.
Thanks, Dana. That's a lot of challenging history to think about. And Liz, one of the things you've said that I think is just really strikes to the heart of it is you said that it's impossible to dream fully unless you hold the whole past. And that's why you leverage architecture and community design not just for revitalization, but to achieve justice as well. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about how this work does both of those things, and maybe some examples of places that you've worked and you've seen that kind of transformation.
Sure, and I wanna start similar to Dana. I really feel it's important to just give a brief visual description for those who might have visual access issues. So I am an African-American woman with medium brown skin. I have very big blue glasses on. I'm also wearing an animal print pink shirt, and I have behind me a bookshelf with lots of colorful books and a giant palm and a colorful woven statue. And I'm also on Hutchin land, similar to Diane. And I feel like that's important to acknowledge in as I lean into answering the question that you posed and the sort of beautiful start that Dana gave to this conversation, because I think that, you know, for so much of the history of this country, and I would also argue around the world, because I think I've had yet to be in a place where, you know, they're not facing these similar constraints where certain bodies are privileged and the comfort of them is centered, and other bodies are extracted from or erased in order to support that comfort. And so I think as I think about, you know, being on Hutchin, or even the many generations of other bodies who have been invisibilized or silenced or erased, and that I'm like standing on those bones. And I think that that is true of pretty much every community that I go and do my work in. And oftentimes there's a tendency to want to say that, like, okay, yeah, the past, it sucked. Let's move forward. We've got a brilliant idea now. We're going to build this new housing. We're going to build this new park. But it doesn't actually work that way, because we are all carrying the wounds of those past injustices. And very often we end up just replicating the same practices of harm, just in different, it looks a little different, but it's still the same at its bones. And that's because we never examined what we did in the past. And so we repeat that behavior. And so in a lot of my projects where I go in is the, you know, the exercise might be like, let's replace 150 units of Section 8 housing, which is what's happening right now in Charlottesville, Virginia, and a project I've been on for a number of years called Friendship Court. Or more locally here in the Bay Area, there's an old power plant that existed for a century in a community that experienced endless amount of industrial uses in San Francisco compared to other neighborhoods that got gleaming office towers and gorgeous parks. And so to say that we're going to remake those places doesn't erase the fact that people are still carrying with them so much pain from the years of injustice that they've experienced, the generations of injustice that their families have experienced. If you saw the reaction that people had yesterday to the George Floyd verdict, and people, you know, in my circle, there were tons of chats with Black women who we were all crying, right? But we also all recognize that even after the tears stopped, we still felt the pain of the generations of harm that had been done. So one trial does not solve everything. And so in my projects, what I try to do is say, how do we break open that past and hold space to hear those stories and use a reckoning around them to try and talk about how do we move forward? So in Charlottesville, what that has been is acknowledging that, you know, we're located two blocks south from where Heather Heyer got murdered, but the wounds of injustice go back to urban renewal, which raised a lot of Black neighborhoods in Charlottesville, or even further back to plantation time, right? And so we have to hold that this community has experienced injustice in a way that has been very deliberately designed. And so building a new housing is not going to make things better. It is, as my client there, Sunshine, says, you know, if we build better housing, if that's all we do, we're just going to help the poor be poor better. And so we really have taken to, yes, there's new housing coming on board, but what are the other ways in which we can actually ensure a future ability for each of these residents, each of these families, to determine their own future. So we're looking at things like generational wealth, cultural belonging, shared power, even to the point of ownership. And all of those things are part of the design project, which I would say most of us who operate as designers, that's not usually what we get as our brief. Our brief is usually around the bricks and mortar. And what my processes tried to do is sort of hold, we have to look at all of this. This all has to be our remit if we want to change the narrative of what existed before.
Liz, thank you for that. It's a lot to take in, and I imagine people are teeing up a lot of questions for us as we go through this conversation. I want to dig for a second, Dana, with you into the specific climate connections. One of the points you make in Greater Green is that housing accounts for 20% of greenhouse gas emissions in our country, which I think most people find quite shocking, even people who are in this space. And I'm wondering if you could just talk a little bit about that today, and how do we think about a move from gray to green in the context of a climate crisis?
Yeah, I think you're right. I don't think we collectively understand that our homes are actually the fifth largest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions because of the way we're heating them, we're cooling them, we're powering them. And so, you know, our homes are generating more carbon emissions than a country like Germany. And I think it's just worth sitting with that for a while. And it goes to our prior question about the history of the housing system. We didn't bring it up, but, you know, the federal government had a huge role in what our communities look like today, because the Federal Housing Authority would only guarantee bank loans to developers who would restrict them to only build housing for white households and would require that those deeds to those homes prevent their being resold to African Americans. So the federal government basically kickstarted the acceleration of today's racialized wealth gap. And so even today, and we call that redlining, you know, the communities that were not invested in were drawn on a map with a red pen, and that is not where investments took place. So over time, these communities today, you can overlay those maps with maps around who was most impacted by COVID, with maps where they're experiencing the most warm days, or where they're experiencing the most flooding. So, you know, as Liz was so artfully saying, we continue to carry forward this pain and decisions made in the past. And so to do anything different, we really have to think differently. We can't just do more of the same and call it green and maybe give it a plaque because it's more energy efficient and it's reduced its carbon emissions. That's not enough. And so, you know, really, I'm reminded of a trip I took to Austin several years ago now, but I was able to sit down with a woman named Tracy who had just moved into her apartment, and she was really excited because she could finally afford this apartment for her and her son. And she didn't know at the time that it was a green building. She just knew that she could afford it. And through our conversation, I learned that her utility bills were next to nothing because it actually had been designed to be net zero energy use. And there were panels to use the sun to heat the water. But what she told me was how delighted she was that she could sleep through the night. Her son wasn't waking up because of triggers from asthma, because the home now had great mechanical ventilation, the materials were healthy. And, you know, we often think that that's the story, that green building is better because it's healthier for people. But it's the real story is that it's better for people and the planet, and we know how to do it, and it doesn't cost more. And we could be doing this every single time. And what I love about this story is that when I walked out of Tracy's home, I saw right in front of me this really beautiful natural space. So this community had been, if you looked at a map, it would have been redlined. This was a very disinvested community in Austin, Texas. but the community rallied up. They were tired of their community becoming the dumping ground for the rest of the city, literally receiving appliances and who knows what, just getting dumped in their backyard. And they took control and they created a community land trust, and they designed the housing to the best green building standards they could think of at the time. And they met a criteria that I had worked on back in the day with Trust Public for Public Land called the Green Communities Criteria. And then they took the land where they weren't developing the housing, and all of it was permanently affordable. But the land that they didn't use for housing, now they allowed it to regenerate and become this great natural space. And, you know, and so what I've found over time is when we start thinking about the way we're providing housing differently and thinking of it as a way of repairing and healing, then it opens up our imagination to think about that whole process. So if we're, you know, bringing in what we're calling green materials, how green are they if we extracted resources and manufactured those materials that polluted another community we just can't see? And so we have to begin connecting the dots. And I think for those of us who care about parks and climate change and housing, it's incredibly important. We don't have the luxury to just be one of these things anymore. These systems are connected. And so we really have to think differently about the entire process of delivering housing so that we're meeting our housing crisis and our climate crisis in one fell swoop and delivering these other benefits.
Could I add?
Thank you for that. Go ahead, Liz.
Yeah, I mean, I think what Dana said is so important, because I feel that so much of, you know, the housing crisis feels so overwhelming. And so it's really easy to focus on quantity. And I would say that, you know, we have crisis of open space, crisis of a ton of things. And the way that we seek to resolve it is like, okay, let's do more, right? And that will fix it. But, you know, to this point of, if you're just replicating bad, it doesn't fix anything. Actually, it just means that we are contributors to harm, which I think we maybe don't do a good enough job of examining. And so separating ourselves from this idea of like ticking a few boxes is really about shifting into this state of, I describe as thinking of ourselves as caretakers, right? Like, I think of myself as a caretaker of the built environment. If I accept that role of being a caretaker, it means that I have a responsibility to everything that is within it. And so that responsibility, if you follow it down the path, it's both to the communities that are impacted directly by whatever line you put on the drawing or wherever you invest your money. But it also goes to what Dana said about, like, there's a community where that material was extracted from, or there might be a community from the person who's going to come and clean the building that you've created, or mow the lawn of that park. And how are we making sure that they are as much taken care of as the people who are paying us, which frankly is what our system privileges, right? Like, we meet the needs of the official client and assume that that automatically covers all responsibility for everything. And I think that we can't talk about solving crises like the housing crisis or the climate crisis until we all shift into this place of care and, like, hold, what does it mean to care for another, whether it is a human being or an animal or a plant? And so I sort of see that we, until we can have a conversation in at that level, that we're just going to be spinning in this circle that, you know, every Earth Day we have these conversations and then we go back to business as usual, and we see the same thing happening again and again. And so I hope that, like, where we are now is, you know, a place where we're finally willing to say that we want to stop the loop and we want to do it differently. And so that requires having these conversations in different ways.
Thank you for that. And I that framing of caretaking is so powerful. I imagine everybody listening today will take that away and really turn it over and consider what it means. So thank you for introducing that concept. I wanted, before we turn to questions, I want to just turn to a question of innovation. Where are you seeing people starting to get some of the pieces right? And I'm thinking about, you know, what the example you gave, Dana, made me think about a park that we were privileged to work with the community on in Bozeman, Montana, Story Mill Park, where we were able to both create restored natural systems, create new kinds of opportunities for the community to interact and a fly fishing area, and also set aside land for housing where there had not been before for some of the working people in the community who've been pushed out as the prices of housing in Bozeman have gone up, up and up and up, and then skyrocketed in the last year. We know Bozeman struggles with a lot of issues, including food insecurity. And so there's a community garden movement that started there that land can be used for. And I'm seeing the most exciting work is, to me, work where those connections are being made, whether it's working with a school, not just on curriculum, but on what the surrounding area around the school looks like and how can that be part of that community. What are you seeing that excites you, and how does it make you think about your vision for the future? And Liz, let me turn to you first, and then I'll turn to Dana, and then we'll open it up for questions.
Sure. I think that that point of looking at the intersections is something that is happening a lot, that we're no longer being in the silos of it's just a housing project or it's just a park. And whatever else is happening is what happens, right? We cannot control economic forces. And so, you know, I see it just even in the projects that I'm taking on and the briefs that I'm receiving from my clients. I mentioned the Charlottesville project earlier, and the brief there was really like, how do we create that sense of wholeness for people? What will it take to do that? And so how do we have to do the process differently? Which, you know, I think starts not just in the visioning of what are the components for the project, right? Even I imagine for that project that you mentioned in Bozeman, to get to that place, it meant that you had to create a process where you are in deep partnership with the city, with the community.
With the community, yep.
Right, yeah, because I think otherwise, you know, we often work from a like community engagement standard where we have a few community meetings, we show some drawings, maybe we do a couple fun little exercises, and then we go off into the sunset and design. And that does not get at equitable communities. And so I think it starts with sort of setting up a process where you're inviting the community from the beginning to come and sit in conversation with you. You're in a place of listening and sort of saying, I want to understand, you know, what life is like for you and what it has been for you. And that becomes the seeds of understanding what you need to do. And so, you know, and that you continue to set up positions of power for community members throughout the entire process so that they are co-decision makers. And so I think that, you know, as I look around the country at different projects that I find to be innovative, you know, I think some of the work that Kankui Design Initiative is doing down in LA, it's an excellent example, and the Coachella Valley is an excellent example of this, of, you know, really building up the capacity within community members to understand that ultimately we're turning over stewardship to them, and that they should be driving what we understand what to do. And that then allows some of these other pieces that are essential ingredients to creating a more holistic community to actually bear fruit. I think just quickly, two other groups that I would mention that are worth looking at is reimagining the civic commons. I think they're doing a lot of great work in some really interesting cities that are also about this kind of coalition building. And Spark is another great initiative happening in a couple of different cities that is pulling together not only open space, but also things like housing.
Great. Thank you, Liz. And Dana, what's your thought about how do you see this going forward, and where do you see innovation that you think is on the right track?
Yeah, I share a lot of the comments that Liz provided, and I'm here representing myself today, but I'm glad that Liz, you highlighted some of my favorite JPB funded efforts in reimagining the civic commons and Spark and others. But you know, I get really excited when it seems that we're beginning to understand that we are connected and that we all benefit from cleaner water, cleaner air, cleaner soils. And as a society where we all have a place to live that we can afford. And so I loved what Liz was sharing, because that's exactly right. I get excited when we stop thinking we are doing things for people. You know, something you do find often in the field of community development, because you feel like you're doing good work and you have a good heart and you care about people, but as soon as you think you're doing something for someone without ever having talked to that person about what they want and need, you're heading down a very, very dark path. And so I think there's just a growing recognition from the ground that we're sick and tired of being extracted from, of being unseen, of being developed for. And I think, you know, as we talk about the Derek Chauvin trial, also just the importance of having people standing and bearing witness and capturing things on camera, you know, that we all have a role to play in the future of our community. As Congressman former Congressman John Lewis said, this is our planet. We all must learn to live together. If not, we will perish as fools. Stand up, speak up, and speak out when you see something that is not right, not fair. We all have an obligation to do something about it. And that couldn't be more true in terms of what we're talking about today, that we need to stop this cycle of developing for people, of thinking that if we just keep doing it the way we are, just slightly better, that things will be different. They won't. And we have to intervene and think completely different and sit down with communities and understand how they're trying to heal and what they need, and then meet the kind of housing need that they have, and do this in places that we have walked away from time and time again. Let's start in those communities that have had a line drawn around them for decades, and let's invest there first.
Thank you, Dana. I appreciate it. Liz, please.
Yeah, I just wanted to offer up a quick resource that I think speaks to what Dana said. So a couple of years ago, I collaborated with a group called Equity Collective that I was a part of, and the Center for Urban Pedagogy, and we created this publication called Dick and Rick. And it actually tells the story of a creation of a park from two perspectives, Dick's perspective and Rick's perspective. And we sort of joke that the not so secret subtitle is How Not to Be a Dick. But the point of it, it's a little tongue in cheek, but the point of it is really that, like, as designers, the moment anyone pays you to go into some place, you have power. And that means that people get impacted by decisions you make. And so how do we think about that power and privilege in a way that we start to like work with the community and sort of see ourselves in service to the community and using that power and privilege to support them? So I just want to advocate for people taking the time to sort of, whether it's Dick and Rick or other resources, the Center for Urban Pedagogy and Creative Reaction Lab in St. Louis have been doing a lot of great workshops around power and privilege, white supremacy, et cetera, to help us understand how we can be better advocates and frankly accomplices to these communities and supporting their ability to have the self-determination over the spaces in which they live.
That idea of self-determination and, to me, deep democracy is so powerful. And I know in the communities where we work, I'm so grateful for the hundreds and hundreds of families who come out and are part of that conversation of what do they want for their community. We're going to turn to some questions. We have quite a few, and I'm going to summarize a couple to try to make sure we can get to as many as possible. One of the things I'm seeing in the questions is people hungry for pragmatic suggestions. You know, I think there's the scope of issues that we're talking about today are global, historic, intersectional. They're really tough to get your arms around, and there are questions about, you know, what are things, how do I actually source materials like this? What are things that I can do, you know, to make my own home less of a contributor to climate change? How do we interact with the regulatory system for these off balance sheet social justice issues? And, you know, one of the questioners points out that in the CEQA roadblocks, the California Environmental Quality Act roadblocks, are weapons in the hands of people who are trying to oppose progress. And so what are some pragmatic one or two things that each of you would suggest people think about on one or more of these scales?
Yeah, Yeah, I'll jump in with a very pragmatic starting place in line with what I was saying before, because we do have a role in our community. If you start where you're living and begin to ask, what kind of housing are we developing here? Do we have any kind of standard? And so I would offer, you could go to greencommunities.org. Vanessa hopefully can put that in the chat. But as I briefly mentioned, back in 2004, a national housing intermediary called Enterprise Community Partners did work with the Trust for Public Land and other both environmentalists and housing organizations and green building experts and building scientists, and came up with a holistic approach to greening affordable housing that takes into consideration the context of where those homes are being developed, access to natural spaces and parks, as well as their performance from a climate change perspective. And those criteria have evolved over time. Every 2 years, they get slightly updated. But when I was working on this for over a decade, we were able to get 27 housing finance agencies to adopt the Green Communities criteria so that you can only build housing that meets the criteria if you want to access public financing. And so I would say we can do more of that. We need to make sure that the criteria are part of any housing program. And if you are interested in doing something in your own home, take a look at the criteria, see what elements you could integrate into your own home and take some steps forward. I think that's a very pragmatic place to start, both in your own home and then also asking what kind of housing does your city or state have, and begin getting involved and making sure that we're ending this sort of mutually reinforcing cycle of just building more housing, but really switching to a paradigm to make sure that we are addressing the housing needs of people in their communities and the climate crisis if one fell swoop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I feel like what Dana said is exactly right. And the only things that I would add is that I think it's so easy to get overwhelmed and feel like, well, there's nothing I can possibly do. And I think sometimes we forget the power of just having the conversation, right? Like if everybody's shutting down because we're like, yeah, it's out of our hands, there's nothing we can do, then the conversation doesn't happen. And so it just continues. And so there's power in speaking in public and even just pointing out why, or asking the question why, and forcing people to try and explain it to you. Cause I'm willing to bet most of the time, it's just like, it's what we've always been doing. And very few people have had to explain the why around it. And so even to the point of just using your power to make people uncomfortable and to have to try to talk through a solution, I think actually has some value in it. And then, you know, I try to think of my work in the lens of how am I practicing the future? So I recognize that I exist in a system that is dominated by white supremacy and capitalism. And there's a lot stacked up against me and the folks who I collaborate with, but I try to look for where there are cracks that I can break a chink in the armor, and with the hope that like somebody else is doing the same thing and somebody else is doing the same thing somewhere else. So in thinking about some of the regulatory issues, I might take just one issue and look at, is there a way that we could innovate or do something different within this that just offers a twist that actually serves community members and, you know, comes in under the quote unquote letter of the law. And I think that there's a lot of power in sort of looking at what are bite-sized pieces that you can possibly take that enable you to be able to do that.
Thanks, Liz. And I wanna remind everybody, if you ask you to add your questions to the Q&A, if you put questions in chat, I can't quite juggle chat and Q&A and paying attention to our speakers. So if you put a question in chat, please cut and paste it over to the Q&A so we can get to as many of them as possible. Thank you. And if you put comments in the chat, we'll take a look at those as we close. So one of the questions we got, a couple questions about the pandemic and how that's changing things and a massive reshuffling in how we work. And you know, maybe office spaces will be sitting empty in some cases for years. What opportunities do you see coming out of the pandemic, and whether it's office space specifically or other changes in how cities are thinking about their future. And Liz, you want to address this one first?
Sure. I think I see a couple of things. One, I think that, you know, I when I give talks, I often talk about the fact that this idea of millions living at the precipice of food or housing insecurity, although that feels like so vibrant right now, did not start with the pandemic, right? It existed long before, but I think what has happened is that things have gotten quiet enough, if you will, for many more of us to take notice and to sort of feel some angst about it and feel it a little bit more viscerally than we did before. And so I think, you know, that if we can continue to pay attention, I think that that is really important. And I hope that we don't lose that coming out of the pandemic. I think that it also forced a high degree of flexibility and reactivity and responsiveness that, you know, whether it's giving visual descriptions at meetings or trying to make sure that we meet people's accessibility needs for a community meeting, we should have been doing this before, right? So like my hope is that some of the things that we, or giving people grace for having kids or dogs running through their home and that they can't meet certain things or that they're under certain stress. And so they're just not going to be able to get these things or seeing certain workers is essential. Like all the things that we're noticing now, I'm hoping that we continue to stay on point with noticing that after. When it comes to physical space, I think there's a really interesting thing that's going to happen around both a recognition of which communities got particularly hit during COVID, right? And I think that if just as we sort of thought of like, well, how do we put attention on them for both getting vaccines, getting testing, getting all sorts of resources, those communities still need that attention. So like, how do we create spaces that support them to continue to thrive, not just make it through COVID? And I think that that also extends to like the homeless crisis, right? Like in the unhoused, like what are we doing for them? The idea of getting hotels or finding creative ways in which to house them should not be a short-term solution. And then I think the final thing that I would say that I don't know that we've even started to tackle is, you know, we've had the disappearance of so many businesses and other places during this time. And I think just as we have so much grief for all the lives that we have lost, I think we haven't figured out yet how to process the grief of the places that we've lost in this time. And so for me, that's almost a question mark of what are we going to do to hold space for that grief? Because I think there's a kind of reckoning of what it means when we can get back out in public again.
Dana,
yeah, Liz,
about that one?
Yeah. I do. Such a great question. Thanks for whoever put it in the Q&A. And I think Liz, you nailed it with your answers. I could not agree more. You know, the few thoughts I had to add to what you said, kind of working backwards a little bit, it is, yeah, I mean, COVID-19 exposed what we understood maybe academically or otherwise to be happening in this country. So when we saw who was disproportionately impacted, don't think many of us were too surprised. We were hurt and it was painful to see, but those communities have been ones where we have been polluting, we have been allowing things to happen that other communities don't. You know, communities that had access to natural space and trees and they could kind of leave their home maybe and get some respite, fared differently than communities that just didn't have that. We, I think, really took to heart the importance of what nature can do for us. And, you know, I hope that some of what's come out of COVID-19 becomes practice. How we evict a household so easily and quickly without cause sometimes came to the forefront, and we're still grappling with the eviction crisis that's occurring across our country as a result of the impacts of COVID. How do we think through this more humanely and put some better policies, practices on the books? And then one thing that, you know, really came to light was just how important our homes are to our overall health and well-being. And even though we know they are contributing to the climate crisis, I don't think we understood fully how they're contributing to our own ill health. And so what I saw in communities was children who were getting exponentially more threatened from lead poisoning because of the paint and other materials in their home. And so we just have to, you know, sort of address these longstanding issues that continue to disproportionately harm some people over others. And those some people we know are majority Black, Indigenous, and persons of color. And, you know, Indigenous communities are experiencing this pain, I think, tenfold because of the loss of tribal elders and the history that they contain. And so the pain's not over, people are still dying. And how do we really, I think, not forget what has happened over the past year, what is continuing to happen, and remember, but also think differently about how we want to move forward. It's not going to be enough just to reopen, rebuild. I think what Liz and I are both saying today is that it's time to really think differently.
Thank you. And we have so many questions from the audience. I think that reflects the richness of this conversation and the importance of it and the timeliness of it. And unfortunately, we don't have time to get to all the questions. We did have a question about, and maybe I'll end on this one, how does re-envisioning cities in more equitable ways and planning for this kind of growth for physical space connect to TPL's work on urban parks? And I'm gonna answer one question and ask each of you to maybe throw a thought in on this before we turn to, we have a closing video that's quite good. So I hope everyone will be able to stay on and see it. You know, I think what we're talking about is really centering on community and the power of centering on community. And that's what TPL's urban work is about. That's what all our work is about. That's what our organization is about. And we depend on communities to invite us in. We depend on the engagement with them. And we are so fortunate to do that. But let me ask Liz and Dana if you have a quick answer. Unfortunately, we only have time for quick answers on this one, to any connections you see between this conversation and TPL's work on parks.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, so much of what we see and that we've talked about so far has been like pain from the past, right? And that still continues today. And I think that the places that we call home play an inextricable role in both supporting our story and supporting our ability to be healed, but only if we create spaces that do that, right? Like I think as is, there's too much of an incidence of spaces that actually cause harm. And so engaging in this conversation is asking, how could we shift from space being complicit in harm to complicit in healing?
Thank you. Dana?
Yeah, Liz, we should end right there. Love that. But you know, the only thing I'll offer is just to remember that we're interconnected. So I may care deeply about parks, but that relates to the kind of housing that we're offering and the climate crisis that we're in and all of these other issues we've talked about today. So I would just urge us all to remember that our issues are interconnected and to find those places of interconnection on which to have great conversations and to learn how we can really come together and make this quantum leap forward to address all of these issues, the housing and the climate crisis together.
Thank you. And thanks everyone for the great questions. And we did run out of time, but we saw the questions and we'll be thinking about how to address them in future park bench chats. So we're gonna do something a little bit different today to close out the event. We're gonna leave you with a video that captures what a green, equitable, and healthy community could look like. So this video is a rendering of a real place. It's a project in San Francisco called India Basin. And the communities led the design effort, and San Francisco Recreation and Park Department, the San Francisco Parks Alliance, Trust for Public Land, Liz's firm, Studio O, and others are working with the community to revitalize the area and create a park that is both spectacular and crucial to the health of San Francisco's Southeast communities, which have been historically underserved. Liz, could you share just a little bit about this before we turn go to the video?
Yeah, I think that you hit all the great points of it. I think the other thing that I would add is that it was really looked at as a way to reinvest back in this community. This community is an example of what the lack of spatial justice looks like, from high industrial uses to a prevalence of public housing to not enough park space. And so this is an attempt to really bring a signature park. And I think combined with it, there has also been this parallel process to develop an equitable development plan, to that point of it shouldn't just be about the land development, it's everything that surrounds it. And so the community has been in particular actively involved in that process of shaping this plan. So what you see is just a small essence of maybe like equitable development made tangible, but there are all of these pieces that intersect with it that are talking about how to make this place and how to make the people who live within it whole.
Thank you. All right. Fabulous. Thank you, everyone. And thank you for joining us. I can hardly wait to visit India Base when it's done. Thank you all. Bye now.